Friday, the Tanners have a special guest.
How annoying could one kid be?
Hi, Mom!
It's an all-new Full House when Urkel struts his stuff.
I created something that'll make you love me. I've got a great new cereal. Can I do that? So hang up your pants for the Urkelos rant.
We're Urkelized with Urkelos.
Strawberry banana fruit flavor so fine. Just one little bite and I know she'll be mine.
She'll be Urkelized with
Urkelos. Oh, Laura, when I find you, you'll taste true love. The Urkelized part of this complete breakfast.
Friday at 8, 7 Central, Johnny Gill's Saturday, Laura.
Nah,
it's an all-new Family Matters.
Hey, enough of that.
Then, are the Lamberts ready for a country club?
You're not supposed to repair the furniture.
No, she really speaks her mind. Tell her to stop it.
Step by step, and...
dry, oily...
Mickey begins a life of crime.
I guess we're gonna have to register you in pre-jail.
Baby talk.
What do real daddies do that Billy doesn't do?
Followed by Billy Friday.
It's a rare condition this day and age to read any good news on the newspaper page. Love and tradition of the grand design, some people say it's even harder to find. Well, then there must be some magic clue inside these gentle walls, 'cause all I see is a tower of dreams, real love bursting out of every scene. Smother the blues with tenderness. There's room for you, room for me, for gentle hearts and opportunity. It's the bigger love of the family.
Sitcom, all ye faithful, a Christmas podcast special, where I discuss 25 Christmas sitcom episodes. Please come and listen every day until Christmas. I'm sure we'll feature Fonzie, the Bradys, and Steve Urkel, Dunder Mifflin Mayberry, and definitely Alf. We'll definitely talk about Alf.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another fantastic episode of Sitcom, All Ye Faithful, where today we're talking about Season 4, Episode 10. From a December 11th, 1992, it's beginning to look a lot like Urkel. We're talking Family Matters, and family really does matter. Fast and the Furious taught me that. And I did see, you notice I did say we again, because, folks, I'm not alone again. Today, joining me on the show is a former Geek Mentality guest for Marchie McFly, a future Geek Mentality guest for Marchie McFly, and someone that I've known. I was doing the math today for 27 years. The man who taught me that if I just turn my ball cap a little bit, it looks really cool. And I've been sticking to that all this time. A man who I played copious amounts of Mortal Kombat 2 and NBA Jam, just a lot of Sega Genesis in college. my buddy Jay, Jason. Hello, how are you? Welcome back to the show.
I'm well, thank you. Thank you for the invitation. It's quite an introduction. 27 years is quite a long time. I think we've spoken for a total of 27 minutes over the last 26 of those years.
It's
24. It's like we've never stopped speaking.
Exactly. It's perfect. I let you choose this. I said, I don't know if I threw out a few options but you chose Family Matters. And is there any specific reason why?
Well, I always consider myself an intellectual and a man with great distinguishing taste. I figured, let's go highbrow. You've been muddling for maybe most of the series thus far. So I said, let's elevate things.
And elevate we did.
Certainly did. If anybody's familiar with what we're going to speak about, they've been challenged on an intellectual level.
And I mean, it doesn't get as, like, when they talk about prestige television, I think it started. Oh, I think I unplugged myself, but that's okay. You can still hear me, right?
Yes, I can.
I'm back.
Loud and clear.
So Family Matters is a show that debuted in 1989 as a spinoff. Mm. Do you know what, do you remember what is a spinoff from?
Perfect Strangers.
Perfect Strangers. Yeah, Harriet.
Perfect Strangers.
I think she worked in the building with Cousin Larry. Was she in the elevator or something? I don't remember. But I thought she worked in the building.
I think they both were. She worked in the building, and I think he appeared in some role in that building as well. I think he appeared in that building at some point or another, and they made that connection that they were a couple on that show.
I could be wrong,
but that's how I remember it.
I'd like to remember it.
I'd like to think he
came straight from Nakatomi Plaza.
I think that's true.
I would hope. So the show, it's funny, I was reading it. The show was really supposed to be about Harriet, her husband Carl, and their kids. And then they got Fonzied. They got Fonzied by a young nerd, a neighbor, Mr. Steve Urkel. Now, a few things that I did not realize was, I didn't realize that the mother actually left the show in the last season, and there was another Harriet Winslow.
Yes, she was replaced.
I remember.
Fun fact:
they moved to CBS, I think, for their final season. I remember they moved. I did not know that she was like, enough of this. They're cloning Urkels now. I got to get out of here. So you chose season 4, episode 10. It's beginning to look a lot like Urkel. I watched it. Then I watched it again. Then I said, I got to go back. I went back and watched the pilot episode to see the difference. I didn't realize Richie was always there, little baby. There was a different actress playing Judy. I don't know whatever happened to her. I do know what happened to the other Judy.
She made her way into a different industry.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, somewhat different, you could say. And it was all about Mother Winslow moving in. And she mentioned how she knew the queen. She traveled the world. And then I went back. I said, this isn't good enough. I need to go back and see the first episode that Steve Urkel was in. So I watched a lot of Family Matters today. Steve Urkel was completely, he was the same, but his circumstances, like, he didn't live next door. They didn't know him. Right. They, he was this kid who ate mice. That's what they thought. But he was hilarious right away.
His first appearance was ridiculous.
That was the date one. He's like, nice house for a cop. Like, it was like right off the bat, he was like perfect. He's like, my parents don't want me home. I'm going to stay here for a while. Just unreal. But we fast forward to season 4, and the few notes that this is all about, it's kind of like their take on It's a Wonderful Life. What would it be like if you have to live in Steve Urkel's shoes? The quick
saddle
little
shoes.
It's saddle shoes. The saddle shoes. That's right. By season 4, I didn't realize Judy was still there. I know she left at one point. She just disappeared.
It was probably a couple seasons too late. I don't think she added any value ever.
Yeah, she didn't do anything ever. She was like behind Steve. I was like, is she still there? Oh yeah, she's there. We're getting snow blown all over her. And yeah, young Richie was already there. This guy has gone on to be on Young and the Restless for the past 17 years. So he's still working.
I had no idea. I just learned this.
No Waldo Faldo in sight. No Waldo Faldo, even though he's in the credits. Okay. Mother Winslow doesn't say a goddamn word in this episode.
No, she had no lines, no speaking lines.
And Aunt Rachel, played by Thelma Hawkins, who I feel like she's been in 1,000 sitcoms all the way back to Give Me a Break. That's what I remember.
Yeah, absolutely. Addie.
And she said like 2 words and then she got to sing at the end at least.
Oh yeah. She's got quite the pipes.
She does. And
no, she's not bad.
Shall we get into the nitty gritty of the episode?
Sure.
The excitement begins. Sure. It opens with the Winslows. I wrote the windows, so that's already a mistake. The Winslows are decorating their tree. We got Carl, Eddie, Steve, and again, just Judy. She's just there. Mm. Steve comes in, and I didn't even know what frocking was.
No, I didn't know what that. I had no idea that what this frocking machine was going to do until it started doing what it did.
Which is, it's a giant, basically a snow machine that's strapped to his back like a Ghostbuster. And he makes this giant mess. And the funniest part is Carl knew it was going to happen, just sat down in his chair, no reaction, just waited for it. And snow covering everywhere. Of course, we get the classic Steve Urkel.
Nailed it. Did I do that?
His voice was still pretty high there. So he wasn't like really reaching like in the later years.
Yeah. Well, I thought it was interesting. Eddie opened with a classic Eddie joke, which are very rarely funny. He's got an insult for Steve that it's stingingly bland, but it's typically, that's what Eddie does.
I watched this twice. I already forget. What was the Eddie insult?
He said, nerd of Christmas past. which is funny now somehow. Okay, I take back what I said. It's hilarious. It's actually hilarious. Sorry about that. My apologies, Eddie.
There's a definite theme of nerd, and Laura later says a line about nerds that I just thought was hilariously like it. I don't think it meant to come off like genuine, but it sounded ridiculous when she says it later on in the episode.
Okay.
So we go right to the theme song. Classic theme song. I mean, this had a classic sitcom opening that it's one of those sitcom openings that are made fun of years later by, you know, like Adult Swim has done takeoffs of things like that with the font. Everything's perfect.
Everything. It feels like it came off the sitcom greatest hits album.
Right.
With Full House and the Hogan family and all that's on the same.
Yeah.
Same
LP. It is that rare condition this day and age to read any good news.
On the newspaper.
Page. I'm going to go to a slam poetry and just do that.
Yeah.
So we cut back to Steve is outside the mall, the shopping center. He's waiting for Laura in, I wrote down his Urkel mobile. I don't know if it had a name.
It may have had a name. I don't recall, but I do know that he was illegally parked. He was there and that was not a parking spot. And he was directly in front of a hydrant. I don't know. It was a family show. I don't know. Those are the kind of things that they want to perpetuate on there. I mean, there's always a moral. This is the way he's parking. It's reckless.
Car seems like ahead of its
time.
That
mall caught on fire. If there was a fire.
They couldn't walk around the 2-foot car with those. He parked it too close to the hydrant.
Yeah.
You could get 3 firefighters to move the car. With Steve in it, they could do it.
2. Same tops.
He shows up to pick her up. I don't think she was even looking to be picked up. I guess he's stalking her. He drives by with his little smart. I mean, that's a smart car. That's like ahead of its time, really. And he's got a little Christmas horn. She seems to not notice until she sees the horn. She comes outside, sitting down, was doing some sort of charity. I don't remember what it was. Feeding the needy of some sort.
They were handing out toys to the homeless.
That's what it was,
I believe. But is it? I'm not sure. That probably is not the first appearance of that vehicle. So I mean, she must know this vehicle from another episode. And I don't see how you miss it. It was parked away, and there are Christmas lights on it. So I don't know how she doesn't see it. She's sitting practically on top of it.
It's not like a white RAV4 that like you see thousands of those in the parking lot. Right.
No,
so she just ignored it. She just ignored it. He shows up. He's like, I'm going to drive you home. And she's like, no, I'll wait for a ride. He picks up her gift. Oh, she said she got a gift for, you know, that she was waiting to get on layaway. He picks up his gift, falls right on it. He's like, luckily the gift broke his fall, and he broke the gift.
The fall broke his gift.
That's right.
Whatever. Yeah, I said it right.
You said it right. I did not.
Yeah, I clearly didn't.
She gets pissed off. She's like, oh my God.
So.
Oh yeah, absolutely. But she takes it to the extreme. Get out of my life. I wish you didn't exist. You wouldn't know what it's like to walk in my shoes for a day. She was this close to saying, I wish you were dead, pretty much, but she didn't.
Yeah. Yeah. I think she had a right. I mean, it was, come on, Steve.
Yeah.
We gotta do better than this. We gotta do better than this.
No social cues.
No, I mean, that was a crystal vase for her mother that she got off a layaway.
That's nice. Yeah.
You don't break things like that. You just don't, Steve. I mean, I think he had it coming. He most likely had that coming.
Oh yeah. This absolutely he had coming. And yet he's still one of these guys. It's not going to stop him because he says, I'll go, but I'll never stop loving you. And she spit in his face and then he drove, right? Did I miss that? I think she should have. Yeah.
No, she said it won't work this time. That's his MO.
That's right.
It's been his MO is to do that kind of that
guilt line
to guilt him into that kind of.
He's an incel. Is that what they call him? Incels? I don't know. I've heard that.
Is that what it is? Is it?
It might be. He's the first one.
He's a master manipulator.
That's what
he is. He's a master manipulator, but she didn't fall for it. She stuck to her guns and she set him on his way. So, you know,
Steve Urkel is a son of a bitch for doing this. And
yeah, he
makes a mistake and then he says it's your fault, basically. You know, it makes it seem like it's her fault.
He was R. Kelly before R. Kelly.
And as the snow dripped from the sky, it cuts over and we see It's a Wonderful Life playing on the television in the department store window, which feels like an old fashioned kind of thing, seeing TVs in the windows.
Sure.
And you think, oh, It's a Wonderful Life. I think I know what they're going to be doing here. So I was wondering, who's Laura waiting for? Because if Steve wasn't driving her home, I don't know.
I think she was at a bus stop.
Maybe that's what it was. Okay. So out of nowhere, I don't know if I would say legend, but I feel like he should have been a legend. Out of nowhere, T.K. Carter shows up. T.K. Carter from Punky Brewster. He was on Saved by the Bell before it was Saved by the Bell. And then the next thing I remember, I think of him always as Ski Patrol. He was in Ski Patrol. And I said, he's an actor who never hit the stardom I thought he deserved, but he's such a recognizable face of the 80s.
He
pops out of nowhere. And he's like, hey, he tells Laura he's her guardian angel. And of course, she thinks he's some sort of creep. It's like, okay, she moves to the next bench. But she's like, it seems like you came out of nowhere. He's like, I did. And boom, she gets up and he knows her name. How do you know my name? That's when he says who she is. She tries to...
introduced himself as Tyrone P. Jackson.
Tyrone P. Jackson.
It's a hell of a name.
Yeah. I loved it.
Hell of a name. Tyrone P. Jackson. I said, okay. All right, here we go. We're casting a black man in this role.
Was the character's description written first or the name?
Yeah. Either way, we've got casting. Let's get some black guys in here.
I'm picturing the casting and like Jason Alexander shows up and he's like,
I'm sorry, sir.
I'm playing for the role of, oh, okay, I'm just going to leave.
I'm just going to leave.
So she goes and she walks away and he looks at her, disappears, and then reappears hanging from the pole. And she's still not buying that he's a guardian angel, even though he just teleported over to her.
Yeah.
I said, the dude disappears, reappears. She's still not buying it. He pulls out this magic remote control. He makes it stop snowing, and she's still not quite sold. Until she freezes time, now she seems like she believes who he is. He says he's Tyrone P. Jackson, but Ty for short. He wants to grant her a wish. So he can get his wings, because he talked about, you know, how hard it is to, you know, at a restaurant, you get seated by the, I think he said by the kitchen, if you don't have wings. And he says, he's going to grant her wish. She's like, what wish? He said, for Steve to find out what it's like to be you. And then he clicks on his remote and the TV shows the Winslow House in the exact same way that we see it every Friday night. Of course, it's on the ABC, the Angel Broadcasting Network.
It's got the exact same viewing angle.
Exactly. And then we, she's like, that's my house. We go in, we see Eddie and Carl, and everything's pretty normal with them. Eddie, they're doing stuff, and Eddie wants money so he can buy Christmas gifts for his dad. And Carl's like, why can't you manage money like your brother, Steve? It's not, I thought maybe we were going to get Stefan, cool. But no, it's just kind of like, I would assume what Jaleel White was like, just a normal kid. His voice was still pretty high. I was expecting it to be a little lower.
No, it was pretty high, actually.
Yeah. He comes down. He's the perfect son. And Laura's like, wait, Steve's my brother? She's like, no. Steve is Eddie's brother. And she's like, what are you talking about? And she says, well, you wanted to know what it was like for Steve to be you. Now you're going to find out what you'd be like to be Steve or something like that. Yeah. And we see Laura Urkel come in doing a pretty incredible impression of Steve. And she's like, turn this off. This is when he says, now you know what it's like to look like Steve. You're going to know what it's like to feel like. Mm-hmm. He presses something on the remote. I don't know, her soul or something gets transported into the television. She's like, what are you doing to me? And for the rest of the episode, we're inside the Winslow house. We're inside the show within the show.
Right.
Very meta.
She did a great job. Very impressive. All the mannerisms.
Yeah, everything, mannerisms, the there was like something she did where she just kind of turned the head. I was like, that is perfect.
Perfect. The posture, everything was just completely Urkel.
And while they're all kind of, you know, they're all just, she's trying to hit on Steve. He's not buying. He's not into it. He's like, I no thanks. Now we see Harriet bringing in a giant gingerbread house. Mm. And this is when we start to see that in this version, instead of Carl and Steve having being like the nemesis, it's Harriet and Laura, because she's more angry about things.
Right.
Because she does threaten to shoot Laura in a few minutes.
They switch that dynamic.
Yes. So but of course,
prior to that, didn't I thought it was interesting because I don't know, just seeing these things here in these modern times here, in these sensitive times, Laura was so, she's just grossly inappropriate with Steve in that kiss. I mean.
Oh yeah. She was trying to kiss him.
Harassment city.
She was like saying she's all getting, she basically said, the hormones are going.
Oh my gosh.
And Steve was not.
He was not. She was in full Pepe Le Pew mode.
and we can't watch him anymore. Pepe Le Pew's out.
It's canceled.
He's gone.
Laura Urkel might get canceled.
If she was popular enough. Yes, if she was popular enough. If this podcast was popular enough, we might bring to note.
Let's get Laura canceled.
I'm going to do a listen, folks, in the show links, if I live up to it, I'm going to do a change.org petition. We're going to cancel. We're going to get HBO Max to take this episode off, drop it. Drop this episode. And then there'll be copious amounts of articles.
Right. Hashtag believe Steve Winslow.
Steve Winslow. Just the Steve Winslow part. That's
Steve Winslow.
Oh my God.
We're gonna make it happen.
Yeah, Harriet, Steve goes right around. Laura goes right around, gives Steve a big pat on the back, which knocks him, Carl, and Eddie over, crashing, destroying the gingerbread house. And we get Laura's version of, did I do that?
Which was excellent.
Which was very excellent. And then Harriet wants to kill Laura at this point. And Carl's like, come on, let's go. I'll take her upstairs. She's like, that's a good idea. Isn't that where your gun is? Like, whoa. Wow.
I said, whoa. Yeah, I thought the same thing. I said, my goodness.
That's crazy.
These sensitive times.
And it didn't seem to shake Laura at all, because now she's still trying to seduce Steve. But at this point, Steve says the same thing to Laura that she said to him, basically, I don't care about you. I don't want you around. For this moment, you don't exist. I don't want you part of my life. And she says, I'll go.
I'll never stop loving you.
Yeah, he put a little extra sauce. I think he was a little meaner to Laura than Laura was to Steve.
And then he slams the door right in her face, and we get the snow on her face. Falls on her.
That was amazing.
We come back to reality, and Laura feels awful. She says, and she goes, this is the line. She goes, I looked like a nerd and acted like a nerd, but I had feelings just like anybody else. I was like, what? It's like, maybe not say nerd. Like, that's like, I think that's the insult also. But it's like, wow, nerds have, the nerdy nerds have nerdy feelings too.
Yeah. Yeah. She came to that realization.
I said, I guess the moral of the story isn't to stop calling people nerds. Now she regrets yelling at him. But Ty says, you know what? We can actually, I can save you. We can send you back in time to do things differently. And he says he's going to go Christmas shopping. I don't know if this is when he said he's going to go Christmas shopping for God. It's like, what do you get him? He knows. He already knows. It was a cute little joke. Yeah. And we go back. And we see the exact same thing, though I don't know if Laura realized that she was reliving it. I don't know, because I felt like the second time around, maybe stop Steve from breaking the vase. You'd save the vase too, but that didn't happen. Steve still crashes, and she's like, you know what? It's okay. She forgives him. She doesn't freak out. And in fact, she invites him for Christmas. And says, you can drive me home.
Did they both get in that car?
Yes. So he opened the car door. This is one thing I noticed. And he got in first. I was like, wait, Steve, let her get in first. Then you get in. He gets right in first. Then she sits down. And he closes the latch over.
Okay.
Then she invites him to Christmas. Then we go back. And the final scene that, well, is this the final scene? Yeah, they show they're around the Christmas tree about to light up the lights. Everything lights up but the star. And I forgot to mention, and TK said, not TK, Tyrone said that, you know, are you going to get your wings? And he says, just look up in the sky. If a star lights up, that means an angel gets its wings. And I was like, that's kind of difficult because there's all these stars.
Yeah, stars.
But it makes sense at the end. Because the star on the tree's not lit up. Steve takes Laura aside because he wanted to say, he's like, I feel like there's something going on. Either your feelings changed about me or you had a nervous breakdown. Laura says your feelings have changed. And he was like, oh boy, you love me. She's like, no, I just want to be, I know. I think she said from this point on, I'm going to try not to hurt your feelings. That was her. Oh, that's so nice of you.
He makes it hard, though, in her defense.
Oh, he absolutely does.
He's an A1 irritant.
He should be arrested for some of the things he's done. So they go back in, and all of a sudden, the star lights up. I mean, the star lights up so bright that I would be freaked out. And she's like, oh, wonderful. That means Ty got his wings. And he's like, ooh, it's like my guardian angel. Oh, nervous breakdown. That's when she cracked. And then we get Aunt Rachel singing. I think she says something, and then she starts singing, oh, come all ye faithful. The whole family gathers around, and that's it. The end.
That's right.
We get a little thing that says, Family Matters wishes you and yours a happy holiday season, which I love when they do these little things. Like, I think Growing Pains did it too with that kook, Kirk Cameron.
Modern day kook,
Kirk Cameron. It's beginning to look a lot like Urkel. That episode, we're closing in on 30 years. That's like, you know, we were watching this, what were we? I don't even, the 15, I think, when this came out. And it's like, that'd be us right now talking about shows from the 50s. It's just, it doesn't feel the same.
No, it doesn't. I mean, it's a classic episode. I mean, it still works. I mean, I think it's not the most original thing that we've ever seen. However, I think the physical comedy of Urkel and Laura carried.
Yep.
Carried, you know, kind of a blandish, if I'm going to say blandish, plot line.
Yeah, it was pretty quick plot line. Like, yeah. Like it wasn't, sometimes there's an A story, a B story. Just go to the mall.
Go and
meet your angel.
Have a little flashback, but I mean, the Laura. Situation.
She was the shining star.
Shining star,
for lack of a better term.
Huge laughs in there.
Yep.
Huge laughs. I mean, you can't miss when you got talent on the show.
On both sides, right? And then when I went back, I watched like the early episodes. Like she's so young there. I was like she was. I don't know if she was supposed to be kind of nerdy herself. Because she couldn't get dates. She couldn't. She's like, no one's going to like me. But
yes, I think they portrayed her to be kind of, you know, a goody two shoes, so to speak. You know,
but she was like cool later on in her years.
I think she was a little cool. She was never an outcast the same way Steve was, but she was kind of, you know.
And she was smart where Eddie was dumb.
Eddie was dumb, and then they doubled down with Waldo.
Waldo was like,
as if Eddie wasn't dumb enough. Here we come with Waldo, and these two guys are really, really taking dumb to a whole new level.
Waldo, Faldo.
Eddie was never funny. He's a poor man's Theo, a very poor man's Theo.
He's a poor man's Theo. Well, he's kind of, yeah, poor he's there. Theo. Like, oh, yeah, Theo. I mean,
poor man's Theo. I think I watched something this weekend. They have it on one of these, like, CW affiliate shows where they still show that show, and Theo is killing it.
Yeah,
Theo, he's killing it.
Yeah, Theo is a talent. He. Yeah. I mean, I always think of how does it feel to have the big C? That episode where his friend, yeah,
killing me. There was one. Not to go too far off track. There's one where Denise's friends were picking her up. And then he comes in from school. Denise is still inside. He goes, "Dad, there's a bunch of girls in a car honking at me." This guy was.
Well, there's the one where he got the earring, right? Isn't there another one where he's hiding the earring?
Eddie, I always thought Eddie was kind of a disappointment with respect to being a poor man's Theo.
Like,
he wanted to be Theo, but he couldn't. Yeah. He couldn't be Theo.
He was, and once you're playing off Urkel, you got just sit there and deliver the line, be the straight man to let Jaleel go insane, which he did. And I saw something where he said he would do a reboot. I was like, oh my God, I'd watch that. They should do a drama.
Who said they would? I thought Urkel said, Jaleel said he would never do it.
Oh, maybe I missed the never. I thought he said he'd be up to it. Ah, then I misunderstood. Well, I'm sure Eddie would.
I mean, I'm sure they all would at this point. It's not like, you know, we're seeing Jaleel White all over the place.
He's been here and there, and like as like the buddy in sitcoms and stuff. Like he was on some.
Has he?
There was a show with John Larroquette, and it was like Bobby Moynihan, and then he grew up like it was like three different generations.
Okay.
Showed him as a kid with Bobby Moynihan, and then later in life as John Larroquette. And while he was Bobby Moynihan, I think his best friend was Jaleel White. It didn't last very long.
I think he had his own show for a time being, not for a time, for a short time. And I think that it was kind of like an MTV show or something, or maybe even like an internet show. But he's tried some things, but I haven't seen him in the mainstream.
Hopefully he still has the Urkel money. Because there's.
He should.
I mean, even with merchandising, because there were dolls, there were games.
Yeah. And cereal.
Yes, I was just going to say, because at the beginning of this episode, you heard the commercial from the Urkel cereal. This is me. This is how we do it. I'm adding it later, but it's there. When you listen later, you'll hear it. I did not know that. I typed in, like, I was looking for a promo for this specific episode. I couldn't find it, but I found Urkelos.
Okay.
Part of a balanced, nutritious breakfast.
Yeah, so I'm hoping he has something, but I mean, how things go.
I want them to do a full reboot like they're doing Bel Air, make it dramatic.
Oh, you want a dramatic version?
Like dramatic, like just, and it's just called Steve. He's like, did I do that?
The thing is, they got very complicated at the end of that series. So, I mean, do we have the Transformation Chamber? What's going on? There's a lot to reboot.
It was a sci-fi show by the end.
Yeah, I think we've got to forget. We've got to forget some of that and pretend that never happened. Yeah. Maybe we're going to reboot that thing, because the Transformation, it's a game changer. When Carl went in there and came out as Bruce Lee, it was, I think, the whole show.
I don't know. I kind of remember that. Like,
oh my God. Carl went in there and came out as Bruce Lee. That's all. I mean, I need something like that.
Now I need to look that up. Awesome. I think we might have nailed it.
I think we did.
I think we saw
before I say anything further that you need to edit out.
Do you have any? Oh, no. The episode I did the other day with my cousin, it was going so good. And then he said something, I lost it laughing. I have to go back and edit all this out, you jerk. I think we killed it. I think we nailed it. Are there any other thoughts on this episode or Family Matters or Steve Urkel in general?
All good thoughts. I just want to thank you. And you're doing a great job. I'm enjoying this series awesome. This month.
Thank you.
Almost all of it. I probably got a couple of the last few episodes I need to catch on, but it's very entertaining as usual.
Awesome. Thank you very much. And can I count on coming back to talk a little Back to the Future 2 during Marty McFly 2?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Awesome. Because that we touched upon a little last year, but
there's going to be a lot to discuss.
A lot to unpack with that movie.
It's been on TV fairly regularly.
Yes.
Recently, and there's a lot going on there.
Oh yes.
But
we still have a few months until we get there, and we still have a few days left in the Christmas season. But I want to thank my buddy. So you know, you hear more episodes. This is how I ramble.
I have an idea for you. Let me give you this idea. This is an idea. I don't know if this fits the theme, or it's just a rough idea that maybe you can fit it or squeeze it into the theme. But I think, does Saturday Night Live count? It does, not a sitcom per se, but they have a lot of content. Maybe they have episodes that are so Christmassy that you could review that entire episode. That's not a sitcom though, so that kind of falls out of the—
that's right, because I was thinking, because something else. I was looking up shows and they had that there, they had a lot of dramas, and I was like, but I'm really focusing on the sitcom sitcoms. And I pretty much have the rest of this year planned out already. And then I was saying to Tammy, there's this show and this show, and I haven't done this yet. I have so many shows I need to touch on. I can't, I'm bringing it back.
You gotta bring it back.
I will be bringing it back. But until then, and until tomorrow, I want to thank everyone for listening and subscribing. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Geek Mentality. You can find the website at fans.experts.com. And sometimes you can find Jay outside stores in his little tiny car waiting to pick someone up from the mall.
From Zayers
in front of a fire hydrant. So thank you again, Jay, for joining me. And until tomorrow, my friends, here is my theme song.
This is my podcast. I made it. Geek Mentality is what I named it. And I think you should listen and subscribe, 'cause I'm kinda funny and awesome. I think that I'm worth your time, and I'm kinda handsome. My mom says, please listen and please subscribe. At least listen to this episode.
Fans Not Experts.
Family Matters is a Miller Boyette production in association with Lorimar Television, and is distributed by Warner Brothers Domestic Television Distribution.